Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the AABBEcast, How to Recruit More Blood and Cellular Therapy Donors. The moderator for today's program is Dr. Amit Gokhale. Dr. Gokhale is a transfusion medicine attending at Texas Children's Hospital and an assistant professor at Baylor College of Medicine in Houston, Texas. I will now turn over the program to Dr. Gokhale.
Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. And again, welcome to this eCast. As noted, my name is Amit Gokhale, and I'm pleased to be here today to moderate the program. All faculty for this program have signed a conflict of interest form in which they have disclosed any relevant financial interest or other relationships with a commercial interest relative to the topics they will discuss during this program. Such disclosure allows you to better evaluate the objectivity of the information presented. Please report any undisclosed conflict of interest you may perceive to AABB professional development staff at elearning@aabb.org. Today's program objective include: identify the causes of the current blood inventory shortage, discuss how the COVID-19 pandemic affected blood and cellular therapies donations, discuss the pros and cons of paid donors for blood and cellular therapies, and describe possible solutions to increase blood and cellular therapies donations. And now it is my pleasure to introduce the presenters, Dr. Cyril Jacot and Dr. Jennifer Chain. Dr. Jacot is the Medical Director of the Hematology Laboratory and Blood Donor Center, Associate Medical Director of Transfusion Medicine and Therapeutic Apheresis, Assistant Professor of Pathology, and Assistant Professor of Pediatrics at Children's National Hospital in Washington, D.C. Dr. Chain is a Director of Research and Development at Oklahoma Blood Institute, located in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. I will now turn the program over to Dr. Jacot.
Thank you for that introduction. Hello, everyone. I'm Cyril Jacot. I'm going to be starting the first half of this presentation talking about recruiting blood donors. Last year, I gave a presentation as part of a Grifols webinar about blood donation and COVID-19 vaccines, but I don't think this should apply, or it doesn't have too much relevancy for this particular discussion. So as Dr. Gokhale mentioned, these are the learning objectives for our talk, and I will be focusing on the blood donation parts. So first, let me provide some background about how COVID-19 has worsened blood shortages. In the United States, Canada, Europe, and overall about 80 countries worldwide, hospitals rely on a volunteer base for blood donors. Other countries, about 55 to 60 of them, use paid or replacement donors. A replacement donor refers to a situation where, for example, if a person is admitted to a hospital, they are expected to provide friends or families that will donate on their behalf. Blood group frequency varies among ethnicities. The pie chart I have here from the Kentucky Blood Center shows the typical U.S. distribution, which is primarily Caucasian. And you can see that the universal donor, which is group O for red blood cell and AB for plasma and platelets, you can see that they represent a very small percentage of the overall donor population. So O negative is about 7%, and AB, when combining positive and negative, is only 4%. So this is a very scarce resource that I'm talking about for universal donors. Regular basis, the United States Health and Human Services Department implements the National Blood and Collection Utilization Survey, and the last data we have is from 2017, and so certainly that has changed quite a bit since then, but this is just to give you an idea of the amount of red blood cells and platelets that are collected on an annual basis in order to support patients throughout the United States. Now, the inventory constraints do predate the pandemic, and certainly COVID-19 has made things worse. These graphs are from a report that was prepared for Congress regarding the state of the blood donation in the United States. And what is noted is the United States does rely to a fairly large extent on young donors, so for example, high school, college age, and then there's somewhat a bimodal distribution with older donors as well. And one of the concerns that has been noted for several years is that as these regular donors start maybe aging out of the ability to donate, the donor pool is going to be approaching a very difficult situation. Now, more recently, when the pandemic started in March, April 2020 in the United States, there were lockdown measures placed as well as a suspension of elective surgeries. And there was actually quite a response from blood donors in the initial phase, which led to quite an increase in the supply of blood. So part of that was increased donation as well as quite a drop in use of blood because of hospital constraints and lockdowns. But then over time, as things started picking up again, as far as hospital surgeries, hospital care, as well as the virus spikes, you can see that surplus started dwindling. We don't, at least in this graph, it doesn't show more recent data, but you can see that we're sort of a hint that there was a shortfall starting. And that has really worsened over time, to the point that in January of 2022, we really were in a crisis situation where many blood centers didn't have enough inventory to support more than a day or two of blood needs. And we are used to platelets being in short supply because of their short shelf life, but this was affecting Group O and even Group A red blood cells. And so why did, you know, over the last 2 years, how has COVID-19 really caused an impact on blood donations? Well, one of the early things we noticed is that with closures of schools, community centers, places of worship, a lot of places that usually host mobile drives were no longer available. And for many donors, a mobile drive close to where they work or where they tend to congregate with others is a very convenient place to donate. The fixed site may be a drive away, and when a donor doesn't have the time or the availability to drive somewhere else, they may not be able to donate as easily. The lockdowns prevented people from traveling for most activities, but there was also a fear for many donors that there was a risk of infection if they went to a hospital or interacted with other people. And so many people who might have been able to donate chose not to in order to stay safe. Because of the need for physical distancing and frequent cleaning, that does make it difficult to host blood drives. Again, an area where you have a lot of people gathered together was not possible during the pandemic. In the early phase, there was this deferral of elective surgeries, delay of care potentially, which then made potentially patients in a sicker state needing more blood products at a later time if their surgery had been pushed back 3 or 4 months. And as I mentioned, in early 2022, we really had the worst blood supply shortage in a decade. We had an emergency situation. It has gotten a little bit better in the last 2 months, but the situation is still very tenuous. This table here on the right side is pulled from this publication by McCullough and colleagues, was trying to quantify the impact of the pandemic. And they started with a US population of about 330 million. And we all know that there are several restrictions that donors have to meet in order to donate blood. And so when you take those into account, you would expect about 205 million people who would be eligible to donate. Of those, only 8 million actually do. And this is really a testament to those 8 million who support a lot of patient care, and they only constitute about 4% of eligible donors in the country. Due to COVID-19, taking into account the infection rates, they estimated that about 60 million people would have been either infected or impacted by COVID-19. And so if you take those 60 million out, And then you kind of use the same percentages to estimate the amounts of people eligible to donate and then who actually donate. What they calculated is a drop from 8 million donors to 6.5. So a loss of about 20% of eligible donors as a result of the pandemic. What has been noted is there's been a change in sort of the donor population giving blood during the pandemic. There's been an increased proportion in Caucasian donors, and this is data from One Blood in Florida. They notice an increased rate of new donors or lapsed donors, which they defined as someone who hadn't donated in more than a year, and a sharp decrease in donors less than 30 years of age. And that goes along with the closures of universities, high schools. So again, young donors might have had a very difficult time donating because they might not have a way to get to a fixed site. They might have been spread out throughout the country and couldn't really organize events with their friends. And I have a link here. This is a summit that was held by AABB in January. It has a lot of very useful information about the current state and the impact. And so if anybody's interested, I recommend checking that out on YouTube. So now let me talk about possible recruitment strategies to help us get more blood donors to address the situation. So throughout the pandemic, starting back in March, there have been many appeals on a national scale about blood shortages. So for example, the Surgeon General early on wanted to make sure people were aware of the need for blood donors. There were also some of the recruitment efforts took advantage of the fact that there would be interest among donors in getting tested for antibodies to COVID-19. There was also quite a drive to identify convalescent donors before vaccines or other antivirals were available. And many centers also worked to try to convert these convalescent donors, who often were brand new donors, to try to see if they would be interested in becoming regular donors. Some of the other changes that blood centers had to make on a very short time scale were, you know, is emphasizing the use of fixed sites over mobile drives, also putting in place measures within their fixed site to reassure donors that it would be safe for them to donate. So for example, spacing out seats in the waiting area, spacing out the donation chairs, making sure that all the surfaces were cleaned between every donor, which of course means that you are not able to collect as many donors at a given time. There can't be as many people gathered in a room. And so you may have to either have multiple rooms set aside so that you can kind of have more footprint in order to have people donate. Maybe you have to have a longer period of time that staff are available in order to collect those donors. Maybe looking at different areas that are not usually used for blood donations, such as stadiums or convention centers. We're aware that many of those were used as sort of temporary field hospitals, as vaccination centers as well. And so using some of these large areas that were for the most part deserted during the pandemic in order to have places where people could donate. And then greater use of personal protective equipment, masking in order to make sure that everyone feels safe. But of course, that comes with additional costs and some discomfort, especially in warmer areas where people are having to wear a lot of additional layers. As I mentioned, there were appeals early on in order to get the word out that there was a severe blood shortage. And so a lot of centers have partnered with local media to make sure that their audience is aware that their hospital is also affected by these blood shortages. We last December hosted a blood drive at our children's hospital with Fox 5 News, and they also shared experiences from patients and families to essentially put it out there that, you know, a lot of these patients rely on transfusions on a regular basis. We care for many patients with sickle cell disease, patients with cancer, and they are not able to put off their treatment. And so they really do need that reassurance that transfusions are going to be available when they're needed. And sometimes seeing a patient face or a family sharing their experience and the need for blood may be more relatable for certain people than maybe a government appeal, which it maybe doesn't quite connect as much as a patient's face. And so taking advantage of that can be a way to motivate people to donate. January, of course, is National Blood Donor Month because it historically is a difficult time to recruit people after the holidays. So taking advantage of that and increasing visibility of blood donation is important. There are also a number of partnerships with university groups that can be helpful. One that I'm highlighting here is the University Blood Initiative, and I just took a snapshot from their website. And their goal is to engage a young and diverse population to help sustain the blood supply. And they may also be reaching out to potential donors through social media or maybe TikTok videos or other communication forms that are more likely to be used by younger donors rather than maybe a newspaper or something that an older donor would be more likely to encounter. And so sometimes changing the way you're communicating that message might be able to reach different demographics who perhaps traditionally are not blood donors. As part of messaging, it can be helpful to have infographics to help explain to people exactly what happens during a blood donation and how a blood donation supports patients. So these are some excerpts from our website here at Children's National, explaining how much blood people have in their body. With young children, a single person may be able to help four or five different children because their blood unit will be able to be aliquoted out into smaller doses. And so sometimes knowing that you could be helping many patients at once is very gratifying. And then also explaining some of the diseases that might prompt someone to need a transfusion. Anything from a very premature child with a heart defect to a patient with a cancer or a blood disorder. We have a hospital-based donor center at Children's National, and many other hospitals throughout the country also do. And the hospital-based donor centers, they can tap into certain resources that maybe aren't as available to community-based donors centers. And in such a way, maybe they can help sort of supplement or maybe coordinate in order to increase the availability of blood. In a survey of 36 hospital-based donor centers, you can see that many of them, they aren't fully self-sufficient. They usually collect less than their needs, but any amount that they're able to collect, whether it's red blood cells or platelets, helps the blood supply by sort of reducing their need to order from a larger center, which then can maybe divert resources to help other hospitals which don't have a hospital-based donor center. We found that such a donor center can be a tangible way for the community, patient, family, and friends to support the hospital. So if they're looking for something that is different from a financial way, they can organize a blood drive. A lot of donors we have here either received care at Children's National or are related or close friends of people who have, and so they understand the need for blood. And it's also collected near the area of need, so you don't have to worry about transporting it long distances. We also have a work staff who is very devoted to helping patients. And so when we have quieter days, we can usually make appeals to employees to come and donate. And it also has helped insulate us a little bit from the blood shortages. We've been able to meet some of our need through the engagement of our staff. And hospital-based donor centers can also customize their offerings to meet what a hospital needs. So if you need more HLA matched platelets because you have a busy hematology oncology service, or if you need more antigen negative red blood cells because you have a program of sickle cell disease, you can use your HBDC to address that. And down here, you can see some of the reasons why HBDCs have been helpful, not only during this current shortage, but in general. These are the reasons that people feel like their center really helps support patient care at their hospital. Now, the motivation of blood donors has been really an area of interest for many years. And this particular review article from 2018 looked at different types of incentives. So some of them are monetary in the upper part of the table. So this can range from, you know, actual cash payment to reimbursements for travel expenses to tax relief discounts. And then there are also non-monetary incentives, so gifts or sweepstakes, maybe a health check where, for example, you get your cholesterol or blood pressure checked, time off from work, or, you know, community service benefits. What's this particular article noted is that there hasn't been an incentive that has been identified that really all segments of non-donor and donor panels report positive attitudes towards, also have a positive impact on behavior, and have no negative impact on blood safety. And so, you know, there's not a one size fits all. It may sort of depend on your particular community, your particular donor population, what motivates them to donate. And also the monetary compensation can be sort of tricky because, you know, you have to figure out what is the limit at which point you would consider that donor to be paid. And so the FDA says it really should be sort of a small amount of value that is given. And so that may also limit, you know, what you're able to do. But things like sweepstakes, or, you know, we tend to give T-shirts which are branded with our children's hospital. They often have like nice decorated themes depending on the season. So things like that donors do appreciate. It also helps them spread out the word that, you know, I'm a donor at this area, and maybe that would encourage some of their families and friends to find out more about it and maybe try to get involved in blood donation. This is one example of a non-financial incentive that was in one blood in Florida. In May of 2020, they started offering COVID-19 antibody screening to prospective donors. And they did see an increase because there was interest in people finding out if they had COVID-19 or not. This was also part of their drive to get convalescent plasma donors. And so there was an increase. But what has generally been found with some of these incentives is it may get people into the door the first time, but it does not necessarily mean that those people will keep coming back. So there seems to be a different motivation that maybe gets someone to try and donate at first, but maybe fostering loyalty depends on different incentives. And so in various studies, payment does seem to encourage younger donors, but again, doesn't necessarily mean that they'll keep coming back. Repeat donors tend to report that altruism, convenience is the blood center close to where they live, and donation experience are the most important motivators. So if it's easy for them to get to the blood center, they have a good rapport with the staff, the donation experience is quick and smooth, that tends to be what people really look to in order to come back. And then, of course, knowing that they're supporting patients, it does seem like that's really the driving factor as opposed to sort of a reward that they're going to get. Now, there have been some efforts to look into paid platelet donors. And again, that's typically a blood product that's harder to manage because of its shorter shelf life. And so some have looked at, for example, paying potential platelet donors, but then using pathogen reduction to counter the perceived higher infectious disease risk that a paid donor would carry. And so those are still in development. It remains to be seen how that is going to play out. I will note that some academic centers previously had paid donor programs with a very low infectious risk. The FDA does allow paid donor programs as long as you label the blood as such. And so that is an option. But for various reasons, these were closed off because of a change in kind of approach. Now, there is also a question as to whether a paid site would interfere with a volunteer site. Sort of the setup we have right now is there are plasma collection centers, which are paid donors. Those are used, the plasma is used for manufacturing and pharmaceuticals. So it kind of goes down a different pathway than volunteer donors at a blood center, which is used for transfusion. And those two have been coexisting for many years. And so some argue that if you have a paid platelet donor, maybe that could still fit in without interfering too much. But again, it would be a little different because these paid donors would be giving for transfusion as opposed to the plasma collection sites. I will also point out that in Hawaii, there are some house bills that have been proposed that would give tax incentives for blood donors and for companies that support blood drives. So again, trying to motivate donors, but maybe staying away from sort of direct payment, although some might argue that a tax incentive can be viewed as a reward and maybe would encourage a blood donor to not be entirely truthful in the questionnaire, knowing that if they donate, they get a tax incentive. The other part of the story is how would hospitals deal with this situation? In a survey, about 20% of hospitals said they would accept paid donors, but about a quarter said that they would not because of the safety concerns. There might also be an effect on patient-informed consent. So right now, when we tell patients how the testing is done, how the screening is done, we emphasize that all donors are volunteer, and you would have to make sure that the patient is aware that a donor is being paid for their transfusion, and that might affect how willing they are to proceed with a transfusion. In April of 2020, the FDA also made some large eligibility changes. Now, some of these had been under review for some time, and certainly the change was expedited by the public health emergency in the setting of COVID-19. And we implemented these changes in June of 2020. And this table highlights the differences. I kind of broke them into three broad categories. There were many deferrals linked to bloodborne infections. So these are blood exposures, needles, sexual risk factors. And so these were all changed to a three-month deferral rather than a one-year or indefinite deferral. Variant Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, colloquially known as mad cow disease, there was a, instead of all of Europe, they really focused the risk on the United Kingdom, France, and Ireland. And then for travel and malaria risk, it was shortened from 1 year to 3 months. And we looked at the impact that this had during the first year of implementation to see if we were getting many new donors. And we found that about 70 donors on a survey we distributed reported becoming newly eligible thanks to these FDA changes. So a relatively small proportion of the overall number of donors we saw, and this might have been due to the difficulty in getting word out during the pandemic. Some centers have tried partnering with veterans groups or European cultural groups in order to get the word out, because those are the populations who maybe have a higher percentage of becoming newly eligible. We did find that the travel deferral allowed people to come back and donate sooner. And one of the benefits there is, I think if someone is not able to donate for a year or more, that increases their chance that they probably won't come back to donate. You know, blood donation is something that kind of becomes part of your routine. And so if you're not able to do it for some time, it might be harder for you to get back into the flow of it, as opposed to if you only have a three-month waiting period, which, you know, is slightly longer than the typical 2 months if you're a very dedicated donor. And so that might mean that, you know, some of these people actually were willing to come back more because they knew they didn't have to wait as long to be eligible again. Separately, we looked at our deferral rates for these conditions, and we saw that there was quite a drop in travel deferrals, tattoo, body piercing, and a lot of these might have been due to behavioral changes as a result of the pandemic. People weren't traveling, people were avoiding crowded spaces. So, knowing how much of this change was due to the FDA eligibility changes versus COVID-19 is hard to pin down, but we certainly saw a benefit in terms of, you know, we were deferring fewer people. So if we had gone through the effort and were able to get someone to come through the door willing to donate, we had a good chance of them actually being able to successfully donate. You know, the leading deferral is still hemoglobin, and of course that's something that we can't really screen out ahead of time until someone actually comes in and finishes the screening. So what we've covered so far, so, you know, COVID-19 has severely disrupted blood collection efforts nationwide and internationally. Donor centers on a fairly short timeline have had to adapt to loss of mobile drives and emphasizing a fixed site, but maybe changing how the fixed site operates in order to accommodate donors in a way that is safe for them. Appeals from patients and families and peers may be more effective, especially for younger donors. And so, having ability of reaching out through social media or other ways might be able to get you more younger donors. Fortunately, universities and schools are starting to open back up again, so that may certainly help. Paying donors remains controversial, has not shown a strong lasting positive impact in small studies. We did see a slight increase in donor pool eligibility thanks to the FDA changes in early 2020. The other thing that you may consider doing is applying for the variants that allows you to collect women down to a hemoglobin of 12. That might increase your ability to have successful donors. But of course, we all know that the meeting blood needs remains a challenge. Even as the pandemic is for now seems to be ebbing, there are still a lot of supply chain constraints, still a lot of hospital that are looking to catch up on deferred surgeries, and so the need for blood remains very high still. Thank you for your attention.
Hey, thank you, Dr. Jaco. Now we will turn the program over to Dr. Chin.
Hi, thank you guys so much for the invitation and the opportunity to speak at this event. So I'm going to talk about my experiences in recruiting healthy donors for cell therapy collections. And these are going to be allogeneic cell therapy collections that are used for the further manufacture of a cell therapy clinical trial product or for research use. And so this is perspectives from a community-based blood center. So no relevant financial disclosures. And the learning objectives that my talk is going to focus on is discussing possible solutions from my own experience to increase cellular therapy donations and discuss the pros and cons of paid donors for cell therapy products and really why we should or shouldn't do this. So just real quick, a little bit about my background to kind of give you a perspective of where I'm coming from, is that I've been a scientist for almost 24 years. My PhD is immunology. My training is focused on bench research and product development, cell isolation. And so coming to OBI was a little bit of a change in career, although I used a lot of the same techniques and methods and expertise that I had developed. I was really applying it much differently. So I started off with OBI consulting about 6 years ago, and then my main focus up until about a year ago has been to custom develop blood products for the cell therapy space and for research clients. And exactly 12 months ago, in March of 2021, the staff person who was coordinating all of our orders for healthy donor apheresis products left the organization, and so I absorbed her department into my lab and kind of created a new department. And so my goal in the last year has been mostly assisting cell therapy companies to procure this quality donor material for their development of their therapies. And so I'm not a traditional blood banker, and I'm certainly not an expert in donor recruitment, traditional donor recruitment at all. But I have learned a lot in the last year about what makes a good cell therapy product donor and what looks like a good product. And so I thought I would kind of share my experiences with you guys. And so a little bit of perspective, in 2020, before I was involved with the program, there was 108 cell therapy collections, apheresis and bone marrow. In 2021, we had 236 and about 53 so far. So I figure since my takeover in March to March of this year, I've been a part of recruiting about 265 donors for cell therapy collections. So donor recruitment is certainly a secret sauce. Every center has their own way of doing things, especially for traditional blood banking, traditional volunteer donor. recruitment. And this is going to depend on the size of your center, whether it's small or large, whether it's located in a single community, multiple communities, multiple states, how many hospitals you serve. And it's going to be influenced a whole lot by the local culture, the local attitudes, and even local laws towards volunteer blood donation. So in our area, in the central country, Oklahoma, Texas, and Arkansas, we have a very, I would say, slightly easier time than some other places because we have a lot of altruistic donors that will repeat donation a lot. And so our approaches to donor recruitment are going to differ from a blood center that's on maybe one of the coasts. Also, what influences traditional recruitment is the diversity of your blood donor population and the blood recipient population at your local hospitals. And then donor stewardship is always key for recruitment. And while allogeneic cell therapy donor recruitment is also a secret sauce, it's a lot different than traditional recruitment. You're going to have a much smaller pool of donors, and you're probably going to be recruiting for a limited number of collection centers. Like OBI has 17 fixed center sites across our network, but right now we only collect these cell therapy products at one location. So that limits our scope of recruitment. The donors that we do use are going to qualify differently for different clients' product specifications, whether they're male or female, how old they are, whether they're CMV positive or negative, whether they have certain HLA types or other attributes. And so that factors a lot into the recruitment secret sauce. Cell therapy donations are much longer than whole blood or platelet plasma donations, and they require multiple visits to the center. So that requires a different strategy in recruitment. Donors are reimbursed for time and travel for these cell therapy donations, which I know can be controversial. We'll talk a little bit about that later in the presentation. But this does change how donors are recruited. And then, of course, donor stewardship here is also key, but it looks different than traditional recruitment. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to kind of go through a lot of this in my tips for recruiting cell therapy donors. But first, I wanted to tell you just a little bit about our process so you can kind of wrap your mind around where we're coming from and why we do things the way we do. It's because of the process that we've laid out. And other centers might do this process the same. They might do it differently, but this is what we do. So when we get an order for a specific client for a specific product, we first recruit the donor. We look at the client specifications. These are going to be age, gender, CMV status, certain inclusion, exclusion criteria, pre-qualification, like I said earlier, HLA types or certain populations of cells. And then sometimes it's just a repeat donor that the client wants. And then once we recruit the donor, anywhere from 2 days before the collection to 30 days before the collection, we'll bring them in for what we call a pre-screen appointment. The timing here really depends on the client specifications. So some clients want the donor screened no earlier than 7 days before donation, and some have like extra testing that takes longer that they want to do 30 days out in case they have to find a new donor because they, you know, don't meet the qualifications. But when the donor comes in for this pre-screen appointment, they must sign a consent form first and foremost for that collection every single time, and they must understand what they're doing and the risks associated with it. So this would be the apheresis and the bone marrow donations. They must qualify for blood donation using the Universal Donor Health Questionnaire from the FDA. It's used for all blood donors. That's the next thing after signing the consent form. And then we are starting to develop a supplemental questionnaire that's based on the AABB Donor History Questionnaire for cell therapy products. And they must also qualify for donation through that questionnaire. And then our questionnaire also includes client-specific questions. So some clients care about smoking status. They care if they have diabetes. They care about BMI. Certain other things, and so we've added this to our supplemental questionnaire. So even if it's not relative to every single client's protocol, we're capturing that information that makes it a little bit easier for recall in the future. So we take a sample at this pre-screen appointment to run infectious disease marker testing. And so in order to qualify for blood donation, the donor must be negative for all the FDA-required IDMs and then any client-specific IDMs and other test results that are requested. And then if they're donating bone marrow or stem cells, they must pass a physical exam by a physician and be approved for donation. So this all happens days before the donation. And so then on the day of donation, the donor comes in and the product is collected, and we collect to a target cell number. We don't process to blood volume or liters processed. We do calculate how many liters we need to process to reach the target cell number based on the donor's white blood cell concentration, the percent mononuclear cells, and then some kind of minimum expected efficiency of the collection. And then once the product is collected, we send it to the lab for processing. And processing can be as simple as taking a sample off to run a CBC and then labeling the product. And it could be as complicated as running flow cytometry testing, sterility testing, splitting the product, volume reducing, cryopreserving. So we kind of do all options, even some cell isolation we've done. And then once the product's processed and ready to be shipped, most get shipped out the same day to the client or to the contract manufacturing organization. If they're frozen, they might get shipped out at a later date. And so we do two types of products. We do research use only products. And so these would go to just be used in the lab. And then we do GMP products. And these are products for further processing of a clinical product. And this would be for a clinical trial. Neither one of these products are for direct transfusion. So we're not talking about NMDP. We're not talking about auto collections that go back to the same patient. We're talking about for further manufacture or for research. So some of the tips that I wanted to pass along for recruiting or establishing a program to recruit donors for cell therapy collections. I'm mainly going to focus on, when I say cell therapy collections, I mean MNC, HPC, and bone marrow. So apheresis and bone marrow, we are doing one project where we're collecting whole blood and sending buffy coats, and those are getting used for further manufacture. So a lot of this does still apply. It's just I wouldn't really advise anybody getting involved with that at this point. It's very difficult. So the first thing we do is we don't go straight into our large donor database. We narrow down our list to donors who are interested in specifically donating for cell therapy projects. And so we have developed something called the BioLinked database. We've developed it at OBI, but I know a lot of blood centers are using it now to get interest from their donor data, their donor base in participating in these types of collections and other studies. Mm-hmm. And so the database is healthy donors, blood donors. They're already interested in participating in these types of collections. So they'll go in and they'll answer a series of questions that will help us better identify them for certain studies or certain donation types. And so using that BioLink database, we then contact donors directly to gauge their interest in certain types of donations, like specifically. So they might be interested in quote, paid donations, but then we talk to them about the different types of apheresis donations. We talk to them about sample donations, about just doing surveys, or about doing like bone marrow and other things. So we kind of gauge their interest. And while we're gauging their interest, while we're kind of recruiting them, we do tell them a lay version about what these collections are, because we don't want them to be surprised. So if it's an MNC apheresis product, I might say something like, well, a white blood cell donation is similar to a platelet donation, but it takes about twice as long, and it uses two needles, one in each arm. And then I'll tell them what the reimbursement is after that. So if I'm telling them about stem cell donation, I'll say this involves injections of a drug that helps move your stem cells out of your bone marrow into your blood where we can collect them. Or bone marrow donation involves going under anesthesia while bone marrow is collected out of your hip bone with a needle. So very lay terms, but just giving them an idea of what these collections involve, because it's more than just a simple passive whole blood donation. And then I also tell donors what their product will be used for. So I don't really truly know the down and dirty details, but I will know whether it's a research use only or GMP collection. I'll know whether it's going for a blood disorder therapy or a cancer therapy or wound healing. And so I'll just give them a little bit of information. The client's going to use your donation to develop a therapy, or the client is going to use your donation to manufacture a therapy and use it in a clinical trial. And like in the case of one of our clients, this will treat 75 to 100 patients. Your donation will treat 75 to 100 patients. If I know that that's true, we have another client that they'll make 10 to 15 because they use larger doses and it's a different manufacturing procedure. And so I kind of plug those things in, and people get really excited when they think, oh my gosh, my one donation is going to go and treat 100 patients in a clinical trial. That's very exciting. And so that really gets them excited and really helps with recruiting. And so the next thing I do is as I'm calling these donors in and as they're getting experience donating, I kind of keep a database for recall. I keep, you know, their age, gender, race, demographic information, other important things like their CMV status and blood type, HLA type, anything I think that a client might ask for. I keep adding to this database as the clients ask for it. And then I kind of keep some more donor-specific information like, their availability. This donor is only available on Mondays or not on Wednesdays or, you know, no Fridays or whatever. And so that helps me pick which donor I might even call to begin with. And then I might have some notes about recallability, like this donor doesn't ever answer my call, or this donor is interested but is always busy, things like that that also help me know which donors are the right ones to call back for particular collections. Vein access helps. I've started to track the number of liters that they process for a standard product. So like if a donor processes 8 liters to reach 100 billion cells, that'll help me if I need a collection that's 15 billion. I know that they'll process very quickly if they're at 8 liters for 10 billion. Or if I need two collections right on top of each other in the same day, for 5 billion, I know that this might be a good donor because then I can get them in and out and then get another donor in right after that. So it helps me, again, identify certain donors. And then how they prefer to be contacted is also an important thing. And I'm always adding new donors to this database, and it's very slow, but I'm adding to it and I'm keeping it updated as much as possible. So I cannot emphasize this enough. Use text messaging wherever possible. So, of course, the donor has to opt in for text messaging, so you have to be careful there. But I found that most donors that I've interacted with prefer text messaging. They will answer a text whenever I ask them if they are available for a donation. They will ask me questions by text message. I've even had some say, please don't call me, only text me. I even had a 70-year-old donor that I tried to recruit through text messages, and he answered every single one. So it's not even age specific. I think it's just because everybody has access to text messages, and it's just easier for everybody, no matter what age. I've even had one of my screeners call somebody that I recruited and say, hey, can you, you know, trying to get them to schedule their pre-screen. They wouldn't answer until I sent them a text message saying, hey, my screener's trying to get a hold of you. Oh, yeah, then they answer. So I do consider this one of my biggest successes for recruiting these donors is just utilizing text messaging. And I think email can also work where phone calls fail, because I've had some answer emails when I couldn't get them to answer a call. Another important thing for your center, if you're setting up a program or you're trying to expand a program, is to have designated staff and space and procedures. So it is very difficult to add extra tasks to your donor services and to your screening teams and to your shipping staff. And so we've just found that it was easier for us to bring on new recruiters, to have our own screener and phlebotomist that just screened and drew samples from cell therapy donors, We even brought in a contract physician to do our physical exams because our medical staff was just taxed. We also dedicated a screening booth separate from our donor room screening area so that we could come and go as we needed. We expanded our collection area. We're getting more instruments. We have more staff. So if you have two instruments and they're always full, in order to grow your program, you have to get more instruments and more staff. Same with the cell therapy lab. We had to make sure we had the staff and the instruments and the space available to process all of these products as we were expanding. I have my own designated shipping staff. I'm bringing on a data manager to kind of keep track of a lot of these things and some of the clinical trials that we're involved in. And of course, you can't just, you know, use your regular blood center procedures. We've had to develop the procedures for these cell therapy donations over time and develop the documents to do it. So reimbursement for time and travel. We do not like to call this compensation or paying donors because it really isn't paying them. It takes a lot of time to donate these products. 4 to 8 hours for a standard MNC, maybe 5 to 8 hours for an HPC, because there's multiple appointments for injections. A bone marrow donor is going to be out for an entire day because of the anesthesia. They won't be able to go back to work. So, and we require, you know, a hydration plan and preparing for a donation. So it's a lot of work, and there can be a lot of side effects, just uncomfortable side effects from the anesthesia, from the Neupogen, from the anticoagulant in these collections. And so kind of going into this a little bit, why should we pay or reimburse cell therapy donors? The FDA does not prohibit this. You just have to label the product pay donor. But in this 21 CFR 606-121, it talks about labeling products for paid donor if they're for direct transfusion. If they're not for direct transfusion, if they're for further processing, you do not have to label as paid donor. So there's no prohibition there. The enhanced pre-screen process, I think, mitigates the risk that paying the donor will lead to an unsafe product. We also do infectious disease testing on the day of collection. So there's two sets of testing for one product. The collections are longer and require multiple visits, like I just talked about. The donor must prepare. Key here is that cell therapy products are not for direct infusion. So there's going to be weeks and weeks that go by before, and maybe even months and months before the product is ever infused into anybody, and it's tested on the back end after manufacturing for a lot of these same markers. And I think personally very few collections would proceed if they were done on a volunteer basis, because there might be some people that said, yeah, I'll do a 4 or 5 hour collection and take injections. And then the day of, they might say, well, you know, I'm a little busy, or I don't really feel like doing it. And you know, because I think that's what people do with blood donations sometimes, is they just get busy or they just don't feel like it. And it's okay, because it was just a volunteer thing anyway. So I think paying them does help get them over that hump. Well, you know, I'm gonna get reimbursed for this. I have to take time off of work. I'm gonna get reimbursed. So I'll make that extra effort. So why shouldn't we pay donors? There are some arguments there that we can discuss, is that, you know, even though the FDA doesn't specifically prohibit it, it doesn't specifically mention cell therapy products when it's talking about labeling things for further manufacture. So it specifically calls out source plasma and recovered plasma, but not cell therapy products. And some people think that this is a good reason to not pay donors. There's that risk that donors are going to lie about their travel risks and their behaviors in order to earn the reimbursement. But going back to the pre-screens and the repeat IDMs and the products not being directly infused, and the fact that they have to be a volunteer blood donor in our system in order to even be recruited, mitigates those risks. There's potentially risk that the collection programs are going to exploit poor donors. But again, you have to be a volunteer donor to participate, and there is a very thorough informed consent process that goes through our IRB. There's a risk of decreasing the volunteer donor pool. And this is a fairly valid risk, I think, although there is a much smaller fraction of the total blood donors in the cell therapy donation network. And almost all of my donors still make volunteer donations in between the cell therapy donations that they get reimbursed for. Okay, so really quickly, donor stewardship. Donor stewardship is key, right? What does it look like for cell therapy donors? Friendly staff, pleasant phlebotomy experience, that's a given. Minimal time collecting the product. This is key to donor stewardship of a cell therapy donor. You must collect to a target to minimize the anticoagulant side effects and respect the donor's time. So instead of just keeping them on for 8 hours or processing 24 liters, you figure out what the client needs. They need 10 billion, they need 5 billion, they need 8 billion, 15 billion, whatever. And you use some kind of calculator, like a linear regression calculator, to help you figure out how to meet that target. And then as you gather data over time, you're going to realize that your minimum efficiency assumption is probably too low and you're over collecting. And so we're at this stage right here where we're trying to increase our minimum collection efficiency assumption so that we collect even fewer liters to meet our target and not over collect any more than we have to. Part of donor stewardship is having a fair and prompt reimbursement. And this is going to look differently in every area. Some it's a gift card, some it's donor points, and some it's cash or a check. We do checks or gift cards depending on what kind of donation. And it has to be prompt. Donors don't like to wait weeks and weeks and weeks for their reimbursement because, they might have taken off work or spent money to travel to the center. And then I always tell the donor what their product's used for. That's a good part of donor stewardship, especially if it's going to be used to manufacture a clinical trial drug. So quick recap, tips for success of recruiting cell therapy donors. Identify interested donors ahead of time. Track donor info to help with recall. Use text messaging. Designate staff and space and develop unique procedures for cell therapy donors, donations. Reimburse donors for their time and travel. And focus on donor stewardship.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Chain, for the great presentation. So now we can begin the question and answer segment of this program. And I think we're sort of nearing the end of time, so we may have time for maybe one or two questions. I had a question. Let's see. This one would be for Dr. Jacole. So as you mentioned in your talk, most blood donors are white or Caucasian. Can you discuss any efforts being made either by your own donor center or by national organizations about how we can encourage more people of color to participate in the blood donation process?
Sure. Yeah, I think I can list like three different things. So within the slide, like one of the University Blood Initiative, that is a group that is encouraging people of color in college and universities to donate blood. At our center, because we care for many patients with sickle cell disease, we have different programs that parents of patients can participate in. So the parents, they have sickle cell traits, so they're not eligible donors, but they usually have a good network, either through their church or their social network, that they can encourage others to donate. And we find that, you know, if people know, someone that I know well has a child with sickle cell disease and transfusions are a key part of their therapy, then that encourages them to donate. So we have something called the Buddy Program, where some of the donors we've done molecular typing on, and we know that they have particular antigens that match well with patients. So when we recruit them, we tell them that, you know, one of the patients that they're sort of paired up with has a surgery or a treatment coming up. The other thing I'll mention is Dr. Yvette Miller from the American Red Cross. She has a couple of programs, I think ECAST, where she does talk about encouraging people of color to donate. So that's certainly an area of interest. So I would refer people to some of her presentations.
Okay, yeah, we have an interesting question from the audience. I think maybe it's for both of you. Maybe Dr. Chain can take a stab at it first. So the question is, do either of you perceive any changes in your recruitment plans due to increase in gas prices?
That is an interesting question. I would say we usually what we do is donors who come here to the fixed site, we give them parking validation, so that wouldn't change. But I think on occasion we have worked with like Lyft or Uber to get some drivers, so that potentially could affect us, but that is a relatively small pool. When we do mobile drives, though, our big van, I'm sure, uses a lot of gas. So I think in our budgets, we're going to have to, you know, take into account the fact that, you know, these mobile drives do get us a lot of whole blood donors. So we definitely want to keep those going. But I think that is something that we're going to have to take into account going forward.
Yeah, we recruit I recruit for cell therapy donations in the Oklahoma City metro area. But some people live, you know, 45 minutes up to 2 hours away, and, you know, they were part of our program when they live closer, so they'll still come for their donations, but I think they'll probably come less often if with gas prices being so much more expensive, if the reimbursement, it doesn't cover it, we'll either have to up the reimbursement or we'll lose some donors who live farther away.
All right, thank you. Okay. Let's see, we got some more here. This would be for Dr. Chain. So as you mentioned in your talk that cell therapy donors, they do not compensate it, but reimbursed for their time and effort. So are there ever any cell therapy donors who don't want to be reimbursed for their donation?
Yeah, now that we've been calling more people from BioLinked, some of them specifically requested to only participate in non-compensated studies. I got one guy who came in for an MNC donation. When I told him that I was sending his check, he was like, "No, I don't want a check." I said, "Well, it's already being processed, so you know you can do whatever you want with it. You can never cash it. You can buy your wife flowers or donate it." And you know when I said buy your wife flowers, his, you know, eyes kind of perked up. And so he's probably going to use that money to do something nice for somebody else. And there have been a few people that have just turned it down. And some people that could only have time for one donation a month. And so if they do a compensated or a reimbursed donation for me, they don't do a volunteer donation. And so they feel guilty about that. And so, you know, I don't call those people very much so that I don't have to kind of, have them worry about that. So I'm kind of trying to gauge that a little bit now.
I would like to thank Dr. Jaco and Dr. Chain for their excellent presentations. And thank you to everyone who attended and participated in today's program. Today's program is copyright 2022 by ABB with all rights reserved. This concludes today's program. Thank you again for your participation.